This episode of the Virginia History Podcast is brought to you in part by Lynn Witten, our newest Patreon subscriber. For more information about how to become a supporter on Patreon, please stay tuned to the end of the episode. Before I begin, let me also put in a word for Lynn and her family's fantastic barbecue restaurant, Q Daddy's, in Smithfield, Virginia. They're a wonderful family-centered restaurant who serves, in my opinion, the best barbecue in the state. So the next time you're in the Smithfield area, enjoy a meal there. I promise you'll be glad you did.
Carry me back to old Virginia. Carry me back to old Virginia. There's where the cotton and the corn and taters grow.
Two stunning events brought Virginia full circle. In May 1659, Richard Cromwell, son and heir to Oliver Cromwell, Lord Protector of the English Protectorate, resigned under mounting pressure that challenged his credentials. Also, a few months after Cromwell's departure, Virginia Governor Samuel Matthews Jr. died in office, adding to an already confused state of affairs. The General Assembly realistically didn't care too much about who occupied English governance, and hadn't for some time. Most members remained royalists throughout the interregnum, often thumbing their nose at Parliament during the last decade. So when the time came to replace the late Samuel Matthews Jr., there was only one person on everyone's mind: the former governor, William Berkeley. But how would Berkeley's return to power affect Virginia?
Let it breathe, if it doesn't breathe, it's gonna die. Let it see, if we let it be, is it gonna fly? Instead of freeing, if it leaves, we say goodbye. Where we weave, and then we grieve, and then we cry. I wanna tell you before I forget. You're doing well, you know you're living it. You're gonna make it no matter what.
William Berkeley, who never submitted to the parliamentary demands that he'd denounced the monarchy, remained in Virginia during the interregnum. He didn't have much to fear in remaining loyal to the crown, because many of the colonial leaders shared his sympathies. This somewhat reveals that Berkeley's former enemies weren't too concerned with Parliament either. Their interests were more economic in that they were willing to use whatever means necessary to further their business. If the crown or Parliament supported their ventures, then Virginia's merchants were either royal or parliamentary accordingly. Otherwise, Virginians largely governed themselves as they saw fit, something they staunchly cherished. Realistically, Virginia didn't care who ran England's affairs by the 1660s, so long as they were left alone. This shift had been gradually coming for some time, and by the 1660s, one can very apparently see that the English living in Virginia very much so started viewing themselves as Virginians, and not just Englishmen living in Virginia. Sure, they still looked to England for cultural inspiration, but these Virginians began building a society all their own. Approximately 20 families came to dominate the period between the 1660s and the American War for Independence. But before that history began, Sir William Berkeley bridged the gap. Berkeley initially refused the Assembly's March 1660 offer to become Virginia's next governor. His stated concern over taking an office that was not offered to him by anyone opposed to the crown was the issue. Yet, he added that he would take the position if the council and burgesses agreed together to let the burgesses offer the governor's office directly. And if a new government stepped into English power other than Charles II, Berkeley said he'd voluntarily resign once again. The council and assembly easily met Berkeley's stipulations, and provisionally chose him to be governor on March 21, 1660. Sir William's return essentially signaled the end of the Matthews-Claiborne faction. Claiborne and some of the other key players from that dominant alliance still held prominent positions, but their influence never again reached the heights it once held during the last three decades. Regardless, the fact that the assembly was filled by members who attended sessions before 1652 and still after 1660 is one of the strongest proofs that Virginia society developed apart from their English contemporaries. These members, many of whom were involved in removing Berkeley from office in the first place, now unanimously called for his return. In doing so, They once again put their interests ahead of English politics, and Berkeley was deemed the best choice to govern, regardless of his royalist position. Either way, they all must have anticipated what was to come. King Charles' son, who was to become Charles II, celebrated his 30th birthday, as well as the crown's restoration on May 29, 1660. The monarchy was back. Berkeley and the Virginians received news of the restoration by the fall, after which time, Berkeley commanded all officials to proclaim King Charles II as King of England, and that all business done in Virginia was to be done in the king's name. The assembly then went so far as to realize their part in the interregnum, and enacted a law setting aside January 30th, the day that Charles I was beheaded. Virginians were to annually solemnize the day with fasting and prayers that our sorrows may expiate our crime and our tears wash away our guilt. In addition, they passed another law declaring May 29th as a holy day of celebration, in testimony of our thankfulness and joy. Charles received news of Virginia's stance well. He honored Virginia for her outward allegiance during and after the Restoration by calling Virginia the Old Dominion, a name that has proudly stuck ever since. The colony was even called the Fifth Dominion behind England, Scotland, Ireland, and Wales, as men like historian Robert Beverley had printed on his famous History and the Present State of Virginia. Virginia was the Old Dominion, the king's last realm, the one that remained loyal. That was the story, but Virginia had changed. During Berkeley's absence, his office was reduced at the expense of more powerful local governments, as well as the General Assembly. Such actions took power away from the centralized authority and put it in the hands of individuals. Individuals who benefited greatly. They might have been loyal in word, but in action, a new spirit formed that greatly influenced succeeding generations. Historian Wilkham Washburn notes, "This larger shift of power has been chronicled in the story of Virginia from 1625 to 1660. It is the story of a small community of Englishmen transplanted to American shores, living for a time subject to traditional English restraints, then, in a period of rapid expansion, losing their cohesiveness and their values under the impact of the American experience and their own natures. Their political expression soon passed from a passive to an active mode. The law became something they made, not something someone else applied to them. Land was similarly not something bestowed on them by generous parents, but something one took from nature, or nature's surrogate, the Indian. Labor was no longer a privilege allowed the individual by the community, but a precious gift contributed by the individual to the community. In sum, the ordinary people who had removed themselves to the New World soon discovered that they were no longer humble servants of great lords, but were themselves lords of the American earth. If they had the power, why not exercise it? Why not indeed?" Historian Thomas Jefferson Wurtenbaker summarized the change by noting the rapid population growth, 15,000 in 1649 and 40,000 in 1660. That influx drove the land grabs happening during the interregnum. So many who emigrated to Virginia were royalists fleeing parliamentary England. They had some wealth, enough to purchase large tracts of land and hire indentured servants, who were also fleeing England but couldn't afford to pay for the trip across the Atlantic. Upon arriving to Virginia, a new world with fresh opportunities opened to them. Adding free trade to land abundance made Virginia the place to be. Wurtenbaker also calls the 8-year period a training in self-government. There was no king telling them what to do, no governor to veto bills, or threaten burgesses, or intimidate the voters, or overawe the council, or sway the courts of justice. Such a setup taught Virginians to be self-reliant, patient, and stubborn against oppression. As such, Wurtenbaker concludes, if there had been no Commonwealth period in Virginia, possibly there had never been a Bacon's Rebellion. I'm inclined to agree and go one step further. Had there been no Commonwealth, it's likely that there also would have been no War for Independence as we know it. Regardless, Berkeley, the king's staunch supporter, did return to power. How would he now govern this Virginia? Before we look at how Berkeley began his second term, let's briefly talk about what Berkeley did during the interregnum. Because Berkeley wouldn't denounce the monarchy, he officially had a short period to get his Virginia affairs in order and leave the colony after he signed the Articles of Surrender. But due to Berkeley's being held in high esteem even by his former enemies, the Assembly confirmed Berkeley's rights to his land by October 1652. Greenspring wouldn't be taken away. Next, in July 1653, the Assembly made an excuse that Berkeley couldn't leave Virginia at that time because of the present war with the United Provinces. A war that had begun in part because of the hated navigation acts that hurt free trade with the Dutch and made Berkeley's immediate successor, Richard Bennett, unpopular. After that, no one paid any more attention to Berkeley's remaining in Virginia, and he stayed in the colony as a submissive, though perhaps not loyal, subject of the Protectorate. Historian Warren Billings notes that the 8 years between the governorship is the least documented period of Berkeley's adult life. The little that we do know points to the fact that Berkeley had once again felt financial strain as he lost the income granted to him by being governor. The ensuing Anglo-Dutch War also hurt Berkeley, as he had many connections to the United Provinces. Thankfully for Berkeley's part, Cromwell ended those wars in 1654 based mostly on religious similarities the two belligerents shared. But the war came at a bad time for Berkeley anyway, and lasted just long enough to add more setbacks to his bottom line. Berkeley was still forced to sell some of his remaining land in order to make ends meet. He first sold land on Jamestown Island, before selling a tract from Chip Oak's plantation to William Claiborne, and then a row house at the Capitol to Richard Bennett. Meanwhile, Berkeley focused his attention on making Greenspring profitable. He undertook many agricultural experiments on the plantation, one of which soon focused most of his attention on producing silk. In coordination with the initiatives encouraged by then-Governor Edward Diggs, silk seemed to be the next big thing in Virginia. The Assembly even passed a law requiring all freeholders to raise 10 mulberry trees for each 100 acres of land they owned, or be fined for disobeying the law. Berkeley obliged and experienced some success in growing silk. English merchants also appeared to champion the shift as they supported ongoing Virginia silk-producing experiments. Berkeley was a main component in these experiments, but received very little recognition for his efforts. He very much wanted to diversify Virginia's economy both as a governor and a private citizen. But limited access to the world's markets continued to focus Virginia's growers and merchants on tobacco, even if supply started to meet and exceed demand. As for the political sphere, Berkeley wasn't involved, though he remained close by. The Assembly still had a number of parliamentary supporters, but those supporting the Stuart cause, such as Theodoric Bland, Walter Chiles, Edward Hill, Henry Randolph, and Charles Norwood, Berkeley's cousin, controlled the House and Governing Council of State. Other major allies sat in the House of Burgesses such as John Carter, Henry Lee, Henry Chicheley, Lemuel Mason, and Abraham Wood, to name just a few. You can tell by some of the names on the list that even if Berkeley weren't in office, he was still very well connected to the colony's major players. Most of these men harmlessly visited Greenspring on their way to Jamestown. But one instance, however, may implicate Berkeley's involvement in a conspiracy to siphon money and arms to Charles and his supporters in exile. Precious little is known, but it appears that Henry Norwood, Richard Glover, and Edmund Custis worked together to send money through the United Provinces and into Royalist hands. Supposedly, Berkeley and Norwood formulated a plot during a 1650 meeting at Greenspring. Norwood was to act as Berkeley's agent and carry bills of exchange for an account that Berkeley opened with Glover. Glover would cash those bills and then send money to Royalists abroad. Any remaining funds were to come back to Berkeley when Glover returned to Virginia. Along the way, Norwood misstepped when he had Glover hand over the remaining bills to Edmund Custis, who was told to charter a ship, fill it with arms, and sail to the West Indies. When they arrived at Barbados, the arms were to be sold to Francis Willoughby, leader of the island Royalists. It never came to fruition. Cromwell's agent, John Thurlow, discovered the plot and arrested Norwood, Glover, and Custis on Christmas Day 1645. None of what followed implicated Berkeley's involvement, though it's hard to make a case that he wasn't involved in some manner. Still, Berkeley maintained close communication with Royalist connections throughout the period. Two of those major connections happened to be William's brothers, John and Charles. But overall, the exiled crown and her supporters offered very little hope of a return. They were incompetent, and reports often spoke of debauchery. Perhaps that should be taken with a grain of salt, given that debauchery meant a large basket of things in Puritan-dominated England. On the other hand, Charles and his court in exile often did push social mores to their extremes, as many royal courts often did. But news from abroad began to change in 1658. Oliver died that September. Richard succeeded his father and immediately felt pressure. News of instability began circulating and slowly reached Virginian shores, where an anxious Virginia leadership as well as Berkeley couldn't receive news fast enough. It was against this backdrop that the Assembly and then-Governor Matthews wrestled over colonial control. In the end, the Burgesses forced the governor to submit to their cause, as we noted in the last episode. Then news reports hit Virginia in waves. Richard abdicated. Sir George Booth failed at leading a royalist uprising. Rump Parliament was dissolved, and Charles Stuart might return as king. Then came news closer to home. Matthews died. No one in the colony knew what to do next. There were no laws dictating who should fill the vacancy. There was no second in command, and neither the Assembly nor the Council could put their leader into office. The Council then looked to pre-1652 precedents for an answer and decided to pick an interim governor for the meantime. That governor would then call the Assembly, which was in recess, back into order. Once the Burgesses were in place, they would then either elect the interim governor full-time or someone else as they saw fit. Many leading names filled the list at first, but various issues negated all but one man, Sir William Berkeley. Berkeley, after his initial reluctance, must have taken power once again sometime early in February, though records don't give us an exact date. The Assembly was to remain fully in charge, but they offered Berkeley two concessions. First, they would allow him to form his own council and choose his own secretary based on their approval. Second, they promised to pay what was owed to him in back payment and outstanding claims against the former government. Berkeley, not entirely happy with what was being offered and that his return to office wouldn't be exactly the same as when he had arrived in 1642, accepted the Assembly's offer anyway. In his acceptance address to the Assembly, he said that he should be worthily thought hospital mad if he wouldn't change poverty for wealth, contempt for honor, which really illustrates Berkeley's desperate need for monetary funds. He then met with the Council, a body that could pose considerable political issues for Berkeley. Some of the men on the Council, Francis Morrison, Abraham Wood, and Edward Hill, were close allies, while men like Richard Bennett and William Claiborne were essentially all that remained from the formidable Matthews-Claiborne faction. Then the remaining nine men were little more than acquaintances at best. Berkeley spoke about their unanimous approval and support after the meeting finished. He thanked them all in a deferential manner in order to bring about a harmony of consents, as he termed it. If they worked together, they could bring Virginia an example of peace that would, at last, return our long-afflicted, miserable, distracted country. Thus he was restored to office, and he united the government together under his vision, even if he were submissive to the Assembly. Immediately, trade became central to his focus. On February 25th, word was sent to New Amsterdam Governor Peter Stuyvesant that Dutch ambassadors had arrived to negotiate a new trade agreement between the two colonies. As soon as Berkeley finished uniting his government, he set about negotiating with those Dutch ambassadors. Because of the Navigation Act's effect upon the colonies during the interregnum, Berkeley's decision to make free trade a priority endeared him to all colonial parties. After the spring 1660 assembly ended, Berkeley and Theodoric Bland stayed in Jamestown to hammer out the details of a trade agreement between Virginia and New Netherlands. The deal arrived a few weeks later as Bland, acting as both a governmental figure and a private citizen, shone in the negotiations. The May 1660 Articles of Amity and Commerce were signed by Bland and sent for approval with Virginia's ambassador to New Netherlands, Sir Henry Moody. Stuyvesant agreed to the terms. Free trade opened between the Dutch and English in both colonies. The Dutch would pay export duties on Virginia tobacco at the same rate as other traders. Colonists from either colony were granted access to local courts in each colony. Retrials were allowed to be conducted based on any perceived injustice. Runaway servants would be returned to their rightful masters at the master's expense or the colony treasurer. And lastly, procedures for processing debt claims were set in place. This agreement flouted English demands to keep the Dutch out of the Chesapeake Bay. Berkeley may have wanted to pass something like this in his first term, but he would never think of going against the crown. Further, he also knew that he didn't have the support of the merchants before 1652. 8 years later, however, Berkeley used the relatively unstable government situation at home and in England to do something beneficial for the colony. This agreement wasn't done and dusted just yet, however. He still had to convince the General Assembly and English officials of the treaty's merit. The Assembly was one thing, but which officials was Berkeley to deal with in England? Charles Stuart was still 2 months away from his own restoration, and no one knew for certain in England, let alone Virginia, if he'd return at all. Once Charles claimed the English throne, the new king immediately reestablished Berkeley as Virginia's governor. The thought was that since Charles II had declared Berkeley to be governor years prior, Berkeley was still governor under that declaration. The official declaration of Berkeley's position arrived at Jamestown by September 1660. Berkeley was then bolstered, and he in turn had his and the king's authority read by local officials throughout the colony. Then he realized that he had somewhat of a constitutional crisis of sorts that had to be handled. The laws currently in place were created for parliamentary rule, not monarchy rule of the colony. That made Berkeley the governor of a colony that had created a differing form of government, whether it was enforced or not, than the one that he had left in 1652. He could have just dictated law and proclamations. But he promised the Assembly that such actions wouldn't be done, and he intended to keep that promise. Thus he felt the need to recall the General Assembly, which was in recess during fall 1660, and together they'd fix the issue. When they reconvened, the Assembly first assented to King Charles II as the rightful ruler of England and her colony Virginia. Next came the Assembly's request that Berkeley intercede with the Crown for a general pardon and reacceptance of the Virginians into the King's favor and protection. They then put together a committee that had Berkeley with Theodoric Bland, Nathaniel Bacon, not the later rebel leader, Miles Carey, Robert Ellison, Henry Soane, and Robert Wynne serving together. Their work was to ensure that Virginians' land titles, free trade, and legislature, the Virginia Assembly, would remain in place. In addition, the Assembly repealed any laws passed during the interregnum that would conflict with the Crown's governance. Any other laws that remained would continue and be in force. Finally, the only authority in the colony would be the King's Most Excellent Majesty. All of this hasty work suffices for now, but more needed to be done, especially when one compares the Assembly overhaul done in 1652. But Berkeley had other concerns to handle. He wanted to focus his attention on reforming Virginia's economy. Berkeley had already worked to establish free trade between Virginia and New Netherlands, though he did want to tax tobacco exports going anywhere other than England. The thought was that if Berkeley discouraged tobacco sales to the highest bidders, which were not always English, then colonists would look for other monetary ventures. He wanted colonists to produce silk, leather, and yarn. But soon those ventures would prove futile, and tobacco remained king for the time being. From what we know, it seems that Berkeley came to terms with the reality that other market forces overruled his attempt to regulate and control Virginia's economy. Thus, he didn't push too much further at the moment. To finish out the fall 1660 assembly, Berkeley and the House of Burgesses agreed that he would rebuild a state house to replace the one that had previously burned down. Other budgetary concerns were managed, and land disputes that the Assembly sided with the Indians upon were handled. Then the Assembly was dissolved, and everyone went home. With that dissolution essentially came the end of an era, because the meeting of the next Assembly was certainly the beginning of Virginia's next colonial development. New members were elected who mostly remained in office for the next 17 years. While waiting for his new commission at Greenspring, Berkeley began openly courting the rising Virginia elite. Most important among those that Berkeley courted during this time were the Ludwell brothers, Thomas and Philip. William had never met either brother before 1660, but the Ludwell-Berkeley connection was strong before that time, as Thomas served with William's brothers John and Charles during the English Civil War. Thomas used his proximity to them and the crown to gain an appointment to be the colony's next secretary. Philip, the younger brother, wanted to go to Virginia to see what colonial life was all about. After they arrived in Virginia, the Ludwells quickly proved to be a great boon to William after 1660. Thomas, who ingratiated himself to the Berkeleys, knew nothing about how to be a colonial secretary. That could have been a bad thing, but instead, Thomas diligently worked with William to learn the position and improve upon its foundations in a manner beneficial to Berkeley's office. Both men subsequently developed a close bond that saw them control Virginia during that 17-year period. Philip benefited too. He was given a seat on the Governor's Council, as well as the position of Deputy Surveyor General, which meant that he was in control of appointing all colonial land surveyors in addition to receiving fees from patent filings. The Ludwell advent meant that yet another key 17th century colonial figure's time was at an end. William Claiborne, the one-time Jamestown surveyor and on-again, off-again secretary, was replaced by both Ludwells. His more than 40-year involvement in public life spanned immense change, and now the change passed him by. But Claiborne didn't go lightly. A year after Thomas Ludwell's appointment, Claiborne still held onto the colonial records. It took an act of the Assembly to finally make Claiborne relent. Finally, the slighted former secretary retired to his New Kent County home, Romancoke, never to enter Virginia's politics again. Sadly, not much has been recorded about Claiborne's life, and almost nothing is known about his later years other than that he continued to manage his 5,000-acre Romancoke estate, just north of today's West Point, until his 1677 death. This means that he might have lived long enough to see yet another major 17th century Virginian event, Bacon's Rebellion. He might have also witnessed the beginning of the ultimate fall of his former adversary, William Berkeley, if he indeed lived long enough into 1677 and received news of the rebellion's fallout. Truly, his life spanned many important colonial generations, and he was at the heart of most of it. The rise of men like the Ludwells and the fall of men like Claiborne, Bennett, and Matthews opened the way for Berkeley and his allies to seemingly govern the colony how they desired. But as 1660 gave way to 1661, Berkeley began receiving conflicting news reports from London. Charles II wanted to consolidate his kingdom into a formal empire that centered upon the crown. That could mean that Virginia's independent development would end. Then Berkeley received notice that he was placed on a newly formed Council for Foreign Plantations. Seemingly good news, but it came with a catch. First, there was talk once again of a revived Virginia Company. By this time, most colonial Virginians had no experience with the original company, so outrage wasn't as pronounced as it was in the 1620s to 1640s. But there was an outcry nonetheless. Second, and more damaging to the colony's immediate position, was a revived Navigation Act. The Navigation Act of 1660 was directed firmly against the Dutch once again, the same Dutch with whom Berkeley had just negotiated a favorable free trade agreement. Berkeley and his associates had different plans, and now they had to scramble up different ways to handle threats from across the Atlantic. One of the ideas Berkeley proposed was that he go to England, take his seat on the Council for Foreign Plantations, and serve as Virginia's agent during this trying time. In order to legally do this, the Assembly had to hold new elections, which it did in March 1661, the last Assembly elections for 17 years before it was dissolved, making this elected Assembly the longest-serving governing body in Virginia's history. There were benefits and drawbacks to the lack of elections during this period. Berkeley and his allies benefited from easily passing laws, building relationships, strengthening the House of Burgesses' authority, and increasing power in local courts. The drawbacks are more clearly seen by 1676 in that the long-serving governing body, as well as the aging Berkeley, seems to have mistaken their power and presence while they forgot about certain portions of the colony, but more on that at a later time. The newly elected members in council came together, and Berkeley empowered them to finalize formulating Virginia's new constitution from work begun at the last assembly, as well as pass new economic legislation in accordance with his colonial plan. Lastly, and most importantly from the 1661 Assembly, Berkeley impressed upon them that he needed to return to England to fight for Virginia's position. The Assembly agreed and raised 200,000 pounds of tobacco to pay for Berkeley's trip across the Atlantic. Berkeley then had to set up his interim government to serve in his place while he was abroad. Francis Morrison was chosen to be governor, while Thomas Ludwell was made a co-treasurer with Morrison. Once the Assembly approved these deputy positions and powers, Berkeley finalized his preparations and set sail for London in early June 1661. Little more than a month later, the governor set foot on English soil for the first time in almost 20 years. But when Berkeley returned to England, He came as a Virginian.
Redefine your sins. Despite the darkness, some of these days, when a green can shine your
Thank you again for supporting the podcast. It's greatly appreciated. Please continue to spread the word and help this colony to keep growing. Start by following us on your favorite podcast provider, like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and visit the website. Sharing episodes and other work is the best way to expand the community. Another way to greatly aid the podcast is by providing feedback on iTunes. If you have yet to do so, please take a few minutes and leave us a comment. Doing so helps bring exposure in the iTunes network. It also helps me to know what I need to improve on in future episodes. If you would like to support the work financially, please consider supporting the podcast on Patreon. Links can be found on the website, or one can visit the campaign at patreon.com/VAHISPod to see the choices and rewards being offered for your generosity. And please, join me next time as we continue walking through Virginia's history. Do do bat des bidi do do zen bazen.